After examining the main rules applying to the creation and conclusion of a treaty, I am looking now at the main principles that govern the life of a treaty. The general principle of law that agreements must be complied with in good faith is also enshrined in Article 26 of the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties. Article 27 also reminds us about the application of another general principle of law to the specific context of treaties. This is that states cannot invoke their own internal law to justify the non-compliance with international law, and in this case, the state cannot invoke the provision of its internal law to justify the failure to perform a particular treaty to which the state is a party. The principle of non-retroactivity finds its codified expression for treaties in Article 28 of the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties, and Article 29 establishes that a treaty applies to the full territory of a state unless provided otherwise. For instance, sometimes the United Kingdom has signed treaties by which it has excluded its application to Gibraltar. A corollary of the sovereignty of states and the fact that the states cannot be compelled to obligations that they have not consented to, particularly treaty obligations, is incorporated in the provision that establishes that a treaty cannot create obligations for a third party. In practice, some treaties, the lawmaking treaties, such as those establishing borders, will create legal regimes that impact on third-party states. Article 30 codifies the customary rules that apply to conflicts between sources of international law, and in particular establishes that in case of conflict between successive treaties on the same subject, the newer and more specific treaty will prevail. With the limits of Article 103 of the UN Charter. As we have seen in previous sessions, Article 103 proclaims the superiority of the Charter over any other agreement that's incompatible with the Charter. We have also seen that the competencies of the Peace and Security Council of the African Union enter into conflict with Article 103. Since the Charter gives the monopoly on decisions on the use of armed force to the Security Council of the United Nations, however, for cases of genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes, the African Union, the Peace and Security Council, has also similar competencies, and this is an unresolved issue, an unresolved conflict in international law. As for the interpretation of provisions contained in a treaty, the most important rule is the principle of good faith and following the literal meaning of the written provisions in the treaty according to the ordinary meaning given to its terms. As supplementary means of interpretation, Articles 32 refers to preparatory works and the circumstances of conclusion of the treaty, and also has a reference to problems of interpretation when there is more than one language in which the treaty is authenticated. First of all, the language of authentication has priority over other versions, but if there is a contradiction between different possible meanings for authenticated languages, interpretation should seek to find the meaning that best reconciles different texts, taking into account the object and purpose of the treaty. Finally, if state parties to a treaty want to modify, amend the treaty in any way, in practice, this will mean they will have to renegotiate the treaty and introduce whatever changes they want, and they will require most of the time, unless provided otherwise in the treaty, a renewed consent for the amendment to enter into force.